Hey guys, in this lab, we're going to work with the serverless service AWS Lambda. We're going to create a function and we're going to see how we can trigger executions of that function in a couple of different ways. In the course download, you will find the AWS Lambda folder and this working with lambda.md file. So make sure you've got this code ready. What we're going to do first is we're going to go and create a Lambda function that logs a message to Amazon CloudWatch logs. And we have some Python code here. So what you'll want to do is copy all of this Python code from lines 7 to 24. So I'm going to copy this code. Now what this code does is it simply writes an event to CloudWatch logs with a message. And so we can write a customized message and it's going to appear in CloudWatch logs in one of the log files. So back in the console, I'm simply going to search for Lambda. And there it is, Lambda. Run code without thinking about servers. Great little tagline. So let's create a function in Lambda. And here what we can do is we can author from scratch, choose a blueprint, or you can even use a container image. Well, we're going to author from scratch. And I'm going to give this one a name. And I'm going to call this write to CloudWatch. Next, we need to choose the runtime. We've got several different options, as you can see. So what we're going to choose is we're going to use the latest Python. In fact, the latest would be up here, Python 3.12. Doesn't really matter, 3.9, 3.12, whatever the latest is. When you watch this video, it could be different. Shouldn't matter with this particular code sample. So I'm going to just going to choose one of these runtimes. Next, you've got the option for the architecture. We leave that on x86 64. Permissions are really important to understand with Lambda. If you want your Lambda function to be able to interact with any other AWS services, you will need to supply permissions. Now, by default, it's going to create a new role with basic Lambda permissions, and those permissions will provide access to CloudWatch logs. So I can just leave it as it is. Alternatively, you can use an existing role or choose from various policy templates, which you can find down here. So I'll just leave it on the default to create a new role with basic Lambda permissions. We then have advanced settings. There's a few options here. We don't need to change any of those for now, so we'll just leave those selected or deselected at the defaults. And let's create the function. Once the function's created, you're going to end up on this page here. What we can see is a function overview. We can see our triggers, if there are any. We can see destinations. We're going to go over these in just a moment. Down a little bit lower, we can see the code editor. And it's just written some default Lambda code in here, the hello from Lambda. What I want to do is delete that, paste in the code which we got from the document in Visual Studio Code, and then click on deploy. So that's going to deploy my update. Now, along the top here, there's a couple of really important places. One is configuration. If we click on configuration, we can see there's lots of options here. For example, the default timeout for our function is 3 seconds. We can increase that if we wish to. We've got memory here, 128 megabytes by default. What I want to show you is down in permissions. So permissions, you can see there's a role here, and that role has CloudWatch logs permissions by default. If you need to add permissions to another service, you can always go ahead and edit the role. Also on the monitor tab, this is where we can click on CloudWatch logs once we've executed our function. I'm going to use the test utility here. And what we're going to do is we're going to create a test event. So back in this document here, we're going to create a test event using this test data. And it just says, hello, CloudWatch. So I'm going to copy this JSON. And back in the event JSON here, let's paste this in. Just call this my event. And then I'm going to save and then run a test event. What we see at the top here is a nice green banner, which is saying that it succeeded. And we've got a response here, which says message logged successfully. Bit lower, we can see some more log output, and there's some details here in the summary as well. So how long did it take to run? Because you get charged based on this per millisecond. Which function version was used? $latest is the editable version of the code that we entered our code a few moments ago. You can then publish different versions as you make changes as well. And we can see the log output here. So this should be in CloudWatch logs. So you can click here, or remember, you can come up to the monitor tab and then click on View CloudWatch Logs here. So now we can see this log stream. I'm going to click on the log stream, open up the log stream here, and we can see our message, Hello CloudWatch. And there's a few events related to that individual execution, telling us when it started, when it finished. We've got a report, and then we have the information in the middle there. So that all worked nicely. If I come back to the file here, what we want to do next is see how we can do the same thing from the command line interface. What we're going to do is use this test data. We need to create a file called payload.json. And then we're going to run this command to invoke our function. So first I'm going to copy this JSON data. Let's open AWS Cloud Shell. And I'm going to create a file called payload.json, paste this data in, and then simply save that file. So now I have my file. Next, we want to run this command, but we need to update our function name. Mine's called write to CloudWatch. Next, you'll want to copy this entire command from where it says AWS down to the letter N after JSON. Now the file B indicates that it's a binary format, which is what we want here. So the file, the B on the end here under after file is not a typo. Don't edit that out. So then you want to paste this in and let's try and invoke our function. Now we have a status code 200. That is a success code. And it does say the $latest was executed. That's the latest version of our function. So what I want to do is come back to CloudWatch here and let's just see if it's created a new log stream. No, it's the same log stream. So let's just expand. And what we should see now is we should have an additional event where it says hello from CLI. So that's worked. We've now executed the function both using a test event in the console, and then we've used the command line interface with the AWS Lambda invoke command to invoke our function. Next, I'll show you how we can trigger the function using an event notification from Amazon S3. So what we're going to do now is we're going to upload objects, so files, into an S3 bucket. And when we do that, an event notification in S3 is going to let Lambda know that something's happened, and Lambda is going to pick up the name of the file and associated metadata, and it's going to put that into CloudWatch logs. So we have a slightly updated version of our code here. What we want to do is copy all of this code, and back in Lambda, let's go over to the code page, delete all of this code, paste the new code in, and then deploy. And so now we've updated our code. Now we will need permissions to Amazon S3. So I'm going to go over to configuration, permissions, click on the role name, and for the permissions policies here, all we have is basically access to CloudWatch logs. So what we're going to do is attach a policy. If I type S3, I need read-only access, and then let's add the permissions. Okay, so now the function has permissions to read from CloudWatch logs. So what we can do, we've got the code installed. Let's add a trigger. So if we add trigger and choose source S3, now we need a bucket. So make sure you've got a bucket. Let's have a look at what I've got and what's in my buckets. So if I head over to S3, I've got a few from previous exercises. Any one will do. Maybe this one, my bucket. Okay, that's got a couple of documents in. It doesn't matter if there are things in there already, and it doesn't have to be publicly accessible. So you could just create a new bucket. In fact, let's do that so everyone's doing exactly the same thing. So this is my event notification test. Bit of a long name. Let's make it unique, and we don't need to make any changes whatsoever. So we'll create the bucket, and then we can come back to triggers here. I'll give it a refresh, so it should pick up my new bucket. Next, we're going to leave the default event types here because this is what we want, object create events. I don't need to set any other settings here. I'm just going to acknowledge this warning here and click on add. So now we can see that we have the trigger. If we go back to the bucket and click on the bucket and go to properties, scroll down a little way, we'll see that an event notification is being created. So you can create this configuration through this console as well. So now what should happen is if we upload objects to the bucket, it should execute the code automatically via the trigger. And then we should see an event in CloudWatch logs that includes the name of the file we uploaded. So I'm just going to go and upload a file. Let's choose one of these ones, my pineapple, for example, and click on upload. I'm going to close. Let's do the same again. Add a file. This time I'm going to add my papaya file. You can add anything you want, doesn't matter what type of document. So what we need to do now is go and check if this worked correctly. So I'm back in Lambda, let's go to monitor. In fact, I've already got CloudWatch logs open, but don't forget you can always come and find it from the monitoring tab. Now in CloudWatch logs, I'm gonna go back up a level because I suspected it would create a new log stream, which it has. So if I click on this log stream and then expand, we can see there's a whole bunch of metadata associated with the file and the event. It's an object created put API action. We've got a source IP address. We've got information, including the bucket name here, and the key. The key is, of course, the file name. But now our code specifically prints out the file name as well. So we can see that right here. And you can see a couple of different entries where two different objects were uploaded to Amazon S3. So now we are not just manually triggering it through the CLI or the test event, but we're also having it automatically triggered through an event notification as well. So that's it for this lab. Feel free to clean up those resources. You can simply delete your function and your bucket, but you won't be paying for Lambda functions when they're not being used, and you're not going to go through the free tier with a few test events like this anyway. And S3 does have quite a good storage limit for the free tier as well.